Thank you. one body and one spirit.
There is one hope in God's call to us.
One Lord, one faith, one baptism.
One God and Father of all.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. God of truth and sacrifice, we give thanks for your servant, William Alexander Guerry, who, like the church's first martyr, gave witness to your liberating gospel and echoed Christ's healing words of forgiveness. May we also seek your truth as we offer ourselves in obedience to the same. All this we pray through him who is forever the bishop and reformer of our souls, Jesus Christ, our Savior.
Amen.
Reading from the book of Genesis. The child grew and was weaned, and Abraham made a great feast on the day that Isaac was weaned. But Sarah saw the son of Hagar, the Egyptian, whom she had borne to Abraham, playing with her son Isaac. So she said to Abraham, "Cast out this slave woman with her son, for the son of this slave woman shall not inherit along with my son Isaac." The matter was very distressing to Abraham on account of his son. But God said to Abraham, "Do not be distressed because of the boy and because of your slave woman. Whatever Sarah says to you, do as she tells you, for it is through Isaac that offspring shall be named for you. As for the son of the slave woman, I will make a nation of him also, because he is your offspring." So Abraham rose early in the morning and took bread and a skin of water and gave it to Hagar, putting it on her shoulder along with the child, and sent her away. And she departed and wandered about in the wilderness of Beersheba. When the water in the skin was gone, she cast the child under one of the bushes. Then she went and sat down opposite him, a good way off, at the distance of a bow shoot. For she said, "Do not let me look upon the death of the child." And as she sat opposite him, she lifted up her voice and wept. And God heard the voice of the boy, and the angel of God called to Hagar from heaven and said to her, "What troubles you, Hagar? Do not be afraid, for God has heard the voice of the boy where he is. Come, lift up the boy and hold him fast with your hand, for I will make a great nation of him." Then God opened her eyes, and she saw a well of water. She went and filled the skin with water and gave the boy a drink. God was with the boy, and he grew up. He lived in the wilderness and became an expert with the bow. He lived in the wilderness of Paran, and his mother got a wife from him, from the land of Egypt. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Lord, have mercy.
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 A reading from the letter of Paul to the Romans. Should we continue in sin in order that grace may abound? By no means. How can we who died to sin go on living in it? Do you not know that all of us who have been baptized into Christ Jesus were baptized into his death? Therefore, we have been buried with him by baptism into death, so that, just as Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, so we too might walk in newness of life. For if we have been united with him in a death like his, we will certainly be united with him in a resurrection like his. We know that our old self was crucified with him so that the body of sin might be destroyed, and we might no longer be enslaved to sin. For whoever has died is free from sin. But if we have died with Christ, we believe that we will also live with him. We know that Christ, being raised from the dead, will never die again. Death no longer has dominion over him. The death he died to sin, once for all. For the life he lives to God. So you also must consider yourselves dead to sin and alive to God in Christ Jesus. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Matthew.
Glory to you, Lord Christ.
Jesus said to the 12 apostles, "A disciple is not above the teacher, nor a slave above the master. It is enough for the disciple to be like the teacher, and the slave like the master. If they have called the master of the house Beelzebul, how much more will they malign those of his household? So have no fear of them. For nothing is covered up that will not be uncovered, and nothing secret that will not become known. What I say to you in the dark, tell in the light, and what you hear whispered, proclaim from the housetops. Do not fear those who kill the body, but cannot kill the soul. Rather fear him who can destroy both soul and body in hell. Are not two sparrows sold for a penny? Yet not one of them will fall to the ground apart from your Father. And even the hairs of your head are all counted. So do not be afraid. You are of more value than many sparrows. Everyone, therefore, who acknowledges me before others, I also will acknowledge before my Father in heaven. But whoever denies me before others, I also will deny before my Father in heaven. Do not think that I have come to bring peace to the earth. I have not come to bring peace, but a sword. For I have come to set a man against his father, and a daughter against her mother, and a daughter-in-law against her mother-in-law, and one's foes will be members of one's own household. Whoever loves father or mother more than me is not worthy of me. And whoever loves son or daughter more than me is not worthy of me. And whoever does not take up the cross and follow me is not worthy of me. Those who find their life will lose it, and those who lose their life for my sake will find it. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
Now, a couple of things. First of all, I love the star. It's awesome. It's awesome. And congratulations on a particular fire I heard you had recently. To retire your debt is no small feat. Well done. When my niece was in kindergarten in England, she found herself in the company of a room full of children whose parents, like her own father, were seminarians. The teacher asked, "Can anyone tell us who Abraham is?" Well, her hand shot up. The unsuspecting teacher called on her, hoping, I imagine, for a solid answer, such as, "He is the father of the faith," or maybe, "He is the one through whom God made a great nation." Instead, what the teacher heard was this: "He is the man who banished his wife's slave and her son into the desert and tried to kill his own son later." I would love to have been a fly on the wall that day to see that teacher's face. My niece, like children can do, named what we often keep quiet: the inconvenient truth. We love to tell the story of the father of the faith, Abraham, his wife Sarah, and their journey of faith to a new land. I preached on that text just a couple of weeks ago, and it is indeed inspiring, but we enjoy less well telling the story that happens just before that journey of faith. This story, rooted more in the identity of Abram and Sarai before they became Abraham and Sarah, it is a hard story, a story of enslavement in which slaveholders cast out a young enslaved woman and her baby, the child of her enslaver. Abram and Sarai cast Hagar out with no protection, no food, no shelter, no safety at all. Their role in the story is difficult for us to take in. And then there is Hagar, alone and preparing for her child to die. All she can do is cry out with her last shred of hope in the face of her despair. Sometimes our tears are our courage. Hagar's story is one about which we do not like to speak. Now, our son George introduced a made-up word into our family's lexicon. Unspeakaboutability. Sounds like something Mary Calvin's would say. Unspeakaboutability. It means simply the things we cannot, for whatever reason, speak about. We can't find a way. I am grateful to be part of the Episcopal Church, part of this diocese, because we are learning together in our churches to talk about things that are hard to speak about. In some cases, for the first time in some people's experience, we are talking together about things that have been unspeakable. Race hatred, homophobia, suicide, mental illness, gun violence. We are slow learners, but over time, we have realized that speaking truth is the first step toward changing what must be changed. So folks across this diocese and across our land are talking about the hard parts of our lives. Today, across our diocese, we remember a bishop who early in the 20th century spoke about that which was unspeakable. Bishop William Alexander Guerry raised up a young African-American priest as his candidate for bishop suffragan. By doing so, he spoke into an unspeakable chasm between the races. That chasm was unspeakable, yet it infected every aspect of the life of the church and the world, and still does. For speaking a new possibility, Bishop Guerry was martyred, and we recognize him as a saint. What is it that makes us saints, my friends? What is the difference between the Abraham and Sarah who treated Hagar so poorly and the Abraham and Sarah we extol? And what is it that makes Hagar a saint we revere? What is it that made Bishop Guerry a saint? We say we are all saints of God, and this is true, but we are sinners too. So, how can the saint shine forth from the sinner in us? Well, I submit to you there is one quality above all the rest that shines through to make the saint come forth from the sinner within the human soul. To take a line from a lion we love, courage. Courage is what makes the saint emerge from the sinner. Courage led Abraham and Sarah to become more than their sin against Hagar and her child. Courage led Hagar to cry out in hope in the face of despair. Courage is what allows ordinary folk, saint and sinner like us, to show forth the glory of God. Courage is what changes history. Courage is of the heart. When we act and speak with courage, we reveal the heart God has given us. Being a Christian in every era, and certainly ours is no exception, involves courage. Our vocation is to make visible the pain that others endure in silence, in secret, in isolation. We are called to go to those who suffer, to be with them, to bring Christ's light to the dark night of their souls, as they will no doubt one day do for us. To speak truth into the silent places where sin has taken root. And our gospel for today, even while acknowledging the reality of slavery of his own day, Jesus says nothing is covered up that will not be uncovered, and nothing secret that will not become known. What I say to you in the dark, tell in the light. And what you hear whispered, proclaim from the housetops. My beloved friends of Holy Cross Faith Memorial, you do what Jesus foretells in this gospel. Since your very beginning, you have shed light on injustice. In the same era of Bishop Guerry's tenure, your founders in both of your original sites started a clinic and two schools. And I know I don't need to school you on Reverend and Mrs. Forsyth's courage. One of the first stories Father Will told me on my first visit and tour here was how Reverend Forsyth would stand at the road and check on all of those as they were traveling to and from work each day. Father Will told me that if someone was missing, Reverend Forsyth would check on them. If there were arguments, he'd mediate them. If there were children falling behind, Miss Ruby held them to the highest standards, get them to graduation. By their witness and their presence, day in and day out, this couple commanded respect across this island. They created a culture here of strength, of love, and of community, all in defiance of powers that would have kept them down. Courage. Yes. In your DNA is courage, that strength from the heart that calls forth the saint in every one of us. So, now, in this moment, when you have just completed a faithful arc that led you to burning that note, you've got a wide open future, a season yet to be lived. So I wonder with you, where is your courage needed next? You who, like Abraham and Sarah, have the call of God upon your life here. You who, like Hagar, have the call of God upon your life. You who, like Bishop Guerry, like Reverend and Mrs. Forsyth, have the call of God upon your life together. Where might God be calling you to go now? What is your next frontier of courage? Who needs you most now, beloved? This is the question I would leave you with today. For we know the call of God, as inconvenient as it may be, always takes us out from what we already know, into the wilderness, to wander, to weep as Hagar did, to go toward a land unknown to us where our greatest promise lies, as Abraham and Sarah did. And courage almost always entails making what is unspeakable something we can say, so that we can repent where repentance is needed, so that we can speak and listen. For that is how Christ heals this world, through our brave hearts. You have been given a goodly heritage, one that has made you willing to tackle the places of unspeakability in our land. You are a people who speak about and respond to poverty. By word and deed, you address the needs of your neighbors through the clinic, through food ministry, through housing advocacy. You speak volumes in how you live the gospel. Mr. Rogers once said, anything that's human is mentionable, and anything that is mentionable can be made more manageable. What I say to you in the dark, tell it in the light, and what you hear whispered, proclaim it from the housetop.
So Holy Cross Faith Memorial, what's next? What truth is whispered or kept in secret that it's time to shout from the rooftops? What is Pauli's Island needing you to tackle next? It's hard to ask that question of a people who are already knocking it out of the park. But you know, it's my call to invite you to think about it. So that's what I'm doing. I told the confirmands, those being received that, I said, how do you speak this word to this people? Because I know what you are doing and who you are. So the question is simply, who's still there? Who's still hungry to feed? Who's still sick? You must heal. Who cannot yet be heard? Who needs your voice? Who's still oppressed? Who needs your strength? Who is yet alone and needs your companioning? Where might your courage lead you next, beloved Holy Cross Faith Memorial? What have you wondered about but not yet tried? For whatever it is, you are up to the task. How thrilling it is to have a church like this one, strong in love, strong in courage, strong in ability. How thrilling it is that Christ has you here. And what joys await you next. Whatever the job God has for you, my friends, there will be great joy in saying yes. For like my little niece in a classroom across the sea years ago, you have the courage to get the job done, to speak the inconvenient truth, to reveal what needs to be seen. This I know. So keep listening. Listen for the call of Christ to you now in this new season. Then go. Go out from where you are. Wander if you must. Weep a bit if you must. But mostly, grab hold of the courage you have always had and get ready. For I am convinced, when it comes to the rich life and heritage you enjoy, the best is yet to come. The candidates will now be presented.
I present Mark Epley, Jane Kohler, John Kohler, and Kai for confirmation. I present Patty Epley, Gail Jolie, Carol Sneeslein, and Lisa Wist to be received into this committee.
Do you reaffirm your renunciation of evil?
I do.
Do you renew your commitment to Jesus Christ?
I do, and with God's grace, I will follow him as my Savior and Lord.
Will you who witness these vows do all in your power to support these persons in their life in Christ? Let us join with those who are committing themselves to Christ and renew our own baptismal covenant. Do you believe in God the Father?
I believe in God the Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth.
Do you believe in Jesus Christ, the Son of God?
I believe in Jesus Christ, the Son of the Son of our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead.
Do you believe in God, the Holy Spirit?
I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and life everlasting.
Will you continue in the apostles' teaching and fellowship and the breaking of bread and in the prayers?
I will, with God's help.
Will you persevere in resisting evil? And whenever you fall into sin, repent and return to the Lord.
I will, with God's help.
Will you proclaim by word and example the good news of God in Christ?
I will, with God's help.
Will you seek and serve Christ in all persons, loving your neighbor as yourself?
I will, with God's help.
Will you strive for justice and peace among all people and respect the dignity of every human being?
I will, with God's help.
Let us now pray for these persons who have renewed their commitment to Christ.
Deliver them, O Lord, from the way of sin and death.
Lord, hear our prayer.
The holy and life-giving Spirit.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Keep them in the faith and communion. Of your Holy Spirit.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Teach them to love others in the power of the Spirit.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Send them into the world in witness to your love.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Bring them to the fullness of your peace and glory.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Almighty God, we thank you that by the death and resurrection of your Son, Jesus Christ, you have overcome sin and brought us to yourself, and that by the sealing of your Holy Spirit, you have bound us to your service. Renew in these your servants the covenant you made with them at their baptism. Send them forth in the power of that Spirit to perform the service you set before them, through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Defend, O Lord, your servant John with your heavenly grace, that he may continue yours forever and daily increase in your Holy Spirit more and more, until he comes to your everlasting kingdom. Amen. Defend, O Lord, your servant Jane with your heavenly grace, that she may continue yours forever and daily increase in your Holy Spirit more and more, until she comes to your everlasting kingdom.
Amen. Amen.
Carol, we recognize you as a member of the one holy Catholic and Apostolic Church, and we receive you into the fellowship of this communion. God the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, bless, preserve, and keep you.
Amen. Amen.
Patty, we recognize you as a member of the one holy Catholic and Apostolic Church, and we receive you into the fellowship of this communion. God the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, bless, preserve, and keep you.
Amen.
Defend, O Lord, your servant Mark with your heavenly grace, that he may continue yours forever and daily increase in your Holy Spirit more and more, until he comes to your everlasting kingdom.
Amen.
Defend, O Lord, your servant Kai with your heavenly grace, that he may continue yours forever and daily increase in your Holy Spirit more and more, until he comes to your everlasting kingdom.
Amen.
Lisa, we recognize you as a member of the one holy Catholic and Apostolic Church, and we receive you into the fellowship of this communion. God the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, bless, preserve, and keep you.
Amen. Amen.
Dale, we recognize you as a member of the one holy Catholic Apostolic Church, and we receive you into the fellowship of this communion. God the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, bless, preserve, and keep you.
Amen. Amen.
Almighty and ever-living God, let your fatherly hand ever be over these, your servants. Let your Holy Spirit ever be with them, and so lead them in the knowledge and obedience of your word, that they may serve you in this life and dwell with you in the life to come. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
Peace be with everyone at home.
Walk in love as Christ loved us and gave himself an offering and sacrifice unto God.
Thank you.
Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give thanks and praise.
It is right and a good and joyful thing always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth through Jesus Christ our Lord. In fulfillment of his true promise, the Holy Spirit came down from heaven, lighting on the disciples to teach them and to lead them into all truth, uniting people of many tongues in the confession of one faith, and giving to your church the power to serve you as a royal priesthood and to preach the gospel to all nations. Therefore, we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name.
As we forgive those
hold fast to that which is good. Render to no one evil for evil. Strengthen the faint-hearted, support the weak. Honor and serve all persons. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, and mind. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be upon you and remain with you forever.
Amen. You may be seated. I want to take a moment to draw your attention to a few of the announcements. It's the only thing I get to do today. But before we do that, please join me in welcoming our Bishop, the Right Reverend Ruth Woodless-Sam. So, Deborah, if you would please come forward. I believe this is on behalf of ECW, Episcopal Church Women, as a gift to you.
You can talk.
If I know you, you did good. You're quiet for a while. So be back.
Which is noted on the back of this, we would like to present.
Oh, beautiful.
This is a watercolor that has been done by Nancy Brown.
I love it.
Nancy Brown Nashville.
Thank you.
I can email it.
Okay.
Let me